Eagerly awaiting the arrival of her sister, Mrs. Elizabeth Jordan, and her husband, Mr. Ben Jordan, who are coming to moon for their father, Mr. Abel Merriweather, who is lying dead in his room. She is a vigorous, plump woman, prepared to do any amount of straight talking. She is in black, but not in complete mourning. She listens for a moment and then goes to the window, opens it, and calls into the street.
Victoria! Diggy here?
Ma'am.
Come in, will you?
Yes, mother.
I'm amazed at you, Victoria. I really am. How can you be gallivanting about in the streets with your grandpa lying cold and dead upstairs? I don't know. Be off now and change your dress before your Aunt Elizabeth and Uncle Ben comes. It would never do for them to find you in colors.
Aunt Elizabeth, what are they coming for? They haven't been here for ages.
They are coming to talk over poor grandpa's affairs. Your father sent them a telegram as soon as we found he was dead. Good gracious! That's never them! No! Thank goodness! It's only your father!
Here, hold it, Somilia.
Oh, thank you, Henry. Victoria, be off now and put your white frock on with the black sash. Go, I said.
Okay, Mom.
I'm not satisfied, but it's the best we can do till our new blacks are ready. And Ben and Elizabeth have never thought about the mourning yet. So we'll outshine them there.
I'm wondering if they will come at all. Because when you and Elizabeth quarreled, she said she'd never set foot in her house again.
She'll come fast enough after her share of her grandpa's left.
I suppose it's in the family.
What do you mean by that? Henry Slater?
Oh, sorry. I referred to your father, not to you. And where are my slippers?
In the kitchen, but you want a new pair. Those old ones are nearly worn out. Here, you would better wear the slippers of Grandpa. It's lucky he has just got a new pair.
They will be very small for me, my dear Amelia.
They'll stretch, won't they? I'm not going to have them wasted. Henry, I have been thinking about the bureau of Grandpa's. That's in his room. You know, I always wanted to have it after he died.
You must arrange with Elizabeth when you are dividing things up.
Elizabeth's that sharp. She'll see I'm after it and she'll drive a hard bargain over it.
I won't care to.
Don't look so daft, Henry. Why couldn't we put that shabby old chest of drawers where the bureau is now? Elizabeth could have that and welcome.
Amelia, what are you saying?
Henry, why couldn't we bring that bureau down here now? We could do this before they come.
And suppose they come when we are doing it?
I'll fasten the front door. Get your coat off, Henry. I'll move the chest of drawers to his room.
Will you fasten my frock up the back, Mother?
I'm busy. Get your father to do it.
Dad, will you fasten my frock up the back? What have you got your coat off for, Father?
Mother and me is going to bring Grandfather's bureau down here.
Are we pinching it before Aunt Elizabeth comes?
No, my child. Grandpa gave it to your mother before he died.
This morning?
Yes. This morning.
Grandpa was drunk this morning.
Shh! You mustn't never say he was drunk now.
I thought I would fetch this down as well. Our clock's worth nothing. And this always appeals to me.
Oh, that's Grandpa's clock.
Shh! Be quiet! It's ours now. Victoria, Don't breathe a single word to your uncle and aunt about the bureau and the clock. Come, Henry.
Okay, Mom.
Victoria, if that's your uncle and aunt, you are not to open the door.
Mother, it's them.
You are not to open the door till I come down. Let them knock away. Quick, Henry, quick. Quick. Mind the wall, Henry. Oof, that was a near thing. Open the door, Victoria. Henry, get your coat on and take this and sit down.
Victoria ushers in Ben and Mrs. Jordan and their son Jimmy. She is a stout, complacent woman with an irritating air of being always right. Both Mr. and Mrs. Jordan are clad in deadly outfit of new black mourning.
Well, Amelia, and he's gone at last.
Yes, he's gone. He was 72 a fortnight last Sunday.
Now, Amelia, you mustn't give way. We have all got to die sometime or the other.
I don't see how.
It might have been one of us.
What do you mean?
Oh, sorry.
By the way, it's taken you a long time to get here, Elizabeth.
Oh, I couldn't do it. I really couldn't do it.
Couldn't do what?
I couldn't start without getting my morning dress ready.
We have ordered ours, you may be sure. I never could fancy buying ready-made things.
For myself, it's such a relief to get into the black. And now perhaps you will tell us all about it. What did the doctor say?
Oh, doctor, he's not been near yet.
Not been near?
Didn't you send for him at once?
Of course I did. Do you take me for a fool? I sent Henry at once to Dr. Pringle, but he was out.
You should have gone for another, right, Eliza?
Oh yes, it's a fatal mistake.
Dr. Pringle attended him when he was alive. And Dr. Pringle shall attend him when he's dead. That's professional etiquette.
Well, you know your own business best, but...
Stop it, Ben. It's a fatal mistake.
Don't talk so silly, Elizabeth. What good could a doctor have done?
Look at the many cases of persons being restored to life hours after they were thought to be gone.
But that's when they have been drowned. And I remember your father wasn't drowned, Eliza.
There wasn't much fear of that. If there was one thing he could bear, it was water.
Ben!
I'm sure he was regular enough. Father had been merry this morning. He went out soon after having his breakfast to pay his insurance.
My word, it's a good thing he did.
He was too honorable to have gone without paying his premium.
He must have gone down to Ringo Bell's afterwards, for he came as merry as a sandboy. Then he came to Henry and said he'll not have his dinner and straight away went to his room. When we had finished dinner, I thought of taking a bit of something on a tray. He was lying there for all the world as if he was asleep. So I put the tray down on the bureau, chest of drawers, and went to waken him. He was quite cold.
Then I heard Amelia calling for me and I ran upstairs.
Of course, we could do nothing.
He left us all.
He was gone.
There wasn't any doubt.
I always knew he would go sudden in the end.
Well, will you go up and look at him now or shall we have a tea?
Well, then if the kettle is ready, then we may as well have tea first.
But one thing we may as well decide now is the announcement in the papers.
I saw words in the evening news yesterday. Proper poetry it was and it rhymed. Despised and forgotten by some, you may be, but the spot that contains you is sacred to we.
Oh, that will never do. You don't say sacred to we.
You won't say it if you were speaking properly.
But that's different in poetry.
Oh yes, poetic license, you know.
Well, we'll think about it after tea. Then we'll look through his bits of things and make a list of them. There is all furniture in his room.
But there's no jewelry or valuables of that sort.
Except his gold watch. He promised that to our Jimmy.
Promised to your Jimmy? I never heard of that.
Oh, but he did, Amelia, when he was living with us. He was very fond of Jimmy.
Well, I don't know.
Anyhow, there's his insurance money. Have you got the receipt for the premium he paid this morning?
I've not seen it.
Mother, I don't think Grandpa went to pay his insurance this morning.
He went out?
Yes, but he didn't go into the town. He met old Mr. Tattersall down the street and they both went off past St. Philip's Church.
To the Ringo Bells. I'll be bound.
The Ringo Bells?
That liquor house that John Shorrock's widow keeps. He's always hanging out there. Oh, if he hasn't paid it.
Do you think it was overdue?
I should think it was overdue.
Something tells me he's not paid it.
The drunken old beggar.
After all I've done for him, to put up with him in the house these 3 years, it's nothing short of swindling.
I had to put up with him for 5 years, Amelia.
And you were trying to turn him over to us all the time.
But one thing we may as remember is that he has not paid his premium.
Victoria, run upstairs and fetch that bunch of keys that's on your grandpa's dressing table.
In grandpa's room?
Yes.
I don't like to.
Don't talk so silly, Victoria. There's no one can hurt you.
Can I take Jimmy with
me? No!
Come, Jimmy.
We'll see if he has locked the receipt in the bureau.
In where? In this thing?
Where did you pick that up, Amelia? It's new since last I was here.
Henry picked it up one day.
I like it. It's artistic. Did you buy it at an auction, Henry?
Where did I buy it, Amelia?
Yes, at an auction.
Oh, second hand.
Don't show your ignorance, Ben. All artistic things are second hand.
Mother, mother.
What is it, child?
Mother, Grandpa's getting up.
Do you see?
Grandpa's getting up.
You better go up and see for yourself, Amelia. Yeah.
Come with me, Henry. Come. Shh. Come.
Listen.
Everyone in the family is startled by the sound of Grandfather. Grandpa is dressed in a gay dressing gown in his stockinged feet. Although 70, he is vigorous and well-colored. He is obviously either the grandfather or else his ghost.
What's the matter with little Vicky? Oh, hello. What brings you here? How's yourself, Ben? And Lizzie?
Grandpa, is that you?
Of course it's me. Don't do that, Melia.
He's not dead.
Doesn't seem like it.
You've kept away long enough, Lizzie. And now you've come. You don't seem overpleased to see me.
You took us by surprise, Father. Are you quite well?
What?
Are you quite well, Father?
Yeah, I'm right enough, but for a bit of headache. I wouldn't mind betting that I'm not the first in this house to be carried to the cemetery. Henry looks none so better. Melia, what the dickens did I do with my new slippers?
Aren't they by the hearse, Grandpa?
I don't see them. Why, Henry? Why you have put them on? Give them back to me.
I told him to put them on, to stretch them. They were that new and hard. Grandpa?
Hold it, Vicky.
Thanks. Oh, Grandpa, I'm so glad that you are not
dead. Hold your tongue, Victoria.
What's that? Who's gone dead?
Victoria says she's sorry for your head.
Thanks, Vicky. But I'm feeling better now.
He's so fond of our Victoria.
Oh, yes. He's very fond of our Jimmy, too.
You would better ask him if he has promised his gold watch to your Jimmy.
Oh, I couldn't just now.
Why, Ben? You're in mourning? And Lizzie, too? And Henry? Melia? Little Vicky? Who's gone dead? Is this someone in the family?
No one, Grandpa. A relation of Ben's.
And what relation of Ben's?
His brother.
Damn it! I never had one.
Dear, what was his name, Ben?
Alfred.
Frederick.
Alfred.
Alfred? And where did your brother Alfred die?
In Australia.
Ah, he might be older than you, right?
Yes, 5 years.
Okay. Are you going to the funeral?
Yes.
Oh, no!
No, of course not.
Well, I suppose you have been waiting for me only to begin tea. I am feeling hungry.
I'll make tea. Henry, give Grandpa some pie.
Thank you. I'll make a start.
Grandpa.
Glad to see you have got an appetite, Mr. Merriweather. Although you have not been so well.
Nothing serious, Ben. I've been lying down for a bit.
Been to sleep, Grandpa?
No, I've not been to sleep.
Oh.
I can't exactly call everything to mind, but I remember I was a bit dazed.
Could you see any, Mr. Merriweather?
Yes, but I don't remember seeing anything particular. Salt, Ben?
Of course not, Grandpa. It was all your fancy. You must have been asleep.
I wasn't been to sleep, Amelia. Damn it. I ought to know.
Didn't you see Henry or Amelia come into your room?
Now let me think.
I won't press him, Elizabeth. Don't press him.
No, I won't worry him.
Ah, begad! What the devil did you mean by shifting my bureau out of my bedroom? Amelia, Henry, do you hear me?
What bureau was that, Father?
Why? My bureau, the one I bought.
Was it that one, Father?
Ah, that's it. What is it doing here? Wait. Drat me if that is in my clock too. What the devil is been going on in this house?
Well, I will be hanged.
Well, I tell you what's going on in this house, Father. Nothing short of robbery.
Quiet, Elizabeth.
I'll not be quiet.
Come on, Elizabeth.
Eliza has every right to speak her own mind.
Then she can speak it outside, not here.
Damn it all. Will someone tell me what is going on in this house?
Yes, I will, Father. I'll not see you robbed.
Who is robbing me?
Henry and Amelia. They have stolen your clock, bureau and slippers. They sneaked into your room like a thief in the night and stole them after you were dead.
Shh. Quiet, Elizabeth.
Stop it, Henry.
I'll not be stopped. After you were dead, I say.
After who was dead?
You.
But I'm not dead.
No, but they thought you were.
Oh. So that's why you're all in black today? You thought I was dead? That was the biggest mistake.
Grandpa, I'm sorry.
It didn't take you long to start dividing my things among yourself.
No, Father. You mustn't think of that.
Melia, you always were a keen one to me. I suppose you thought the will wasn't fair?
But did you make a will?
Yes, it was locked up in the bureau.
And what was in it, Father?
That doesn't matter now. I am thinking of destroying it and making another one.
Grandpa, you'll not be hard on me.
I'll trouble you for another cup of tea, Melia. 2 lumps and plenty of milk.
With pleasure, Grandpa.
I don't want to be hard on anyone. Thank you. I'll tell you what I'm going to do now. Since your mother died, I've lived a part of my life with you, Melia, and a part of my life with you, Lizzie. Well, I shall make a new will, leaving all my bits of things to whomever I am living with when I die. How does that strike you?
Oh, it's a bit of lottery for us.
And who do you intend to live with from now, Father?
I'm just coming to that.
You know, Father, it's quite time you came to live with us again. We would make you very comfortable.
No, he has not been with us as long as he has been with you.
Well, I may be wrong, but I don't think Father will fancy living on with you after what happened today.
All I can say is Elizabeth's changed her mind in the last 2 years. Grandpa, do you know what the quarrel between us was about?
Don't be a fool, Amelia. Sit down.
We quarreled because Elizabeth
said. Stop it, Amelia.
We quarreled because Elizabeth said she had enough of you to last a lifetime and we had got to keep you.
All right. Quiet, be seated.
Sorry, Father.
It seems to me that neither of you has any cause to feel proud about the way you have treated me.
If I've done anything wrong, I'm sorry for it, Grandpa.
And I can't say more than that too.
It's a bit late to say it now. You neither of you care to put up with me.
No, Father.
Come, Mr. Merriweather. You have got to live with one of your daughters.
I'll tell you what I'm going to do now. Excuse me. On Monday next, I've got to do 3 things. First, I've got to go to my lawyer and alter my will. Second, I've got to go to my insurance office and pay my premium. Third, I've got to go to St. Philip's Church and get married.
What?
Get married?
How does that strike you?
He's out of his senses.
I said I'm going to get married.
With whom?
To Mrs. John Shorrocks, who keeps the Ringovels. We have fixed up good while now, but I've kept it for a pleasant surprise. Here she is.
Hello everyone. How are you all? And how's my new family?
Oh, I love my new grandma.
I felt I was a bit burdened on new people. So I found someone who would think it a pleasant surprise to look after me. We'll be glad to see you at the ceremony. Till Monday next, 12 o'clock at St. Philip's Church. Bye.
With the announcement of his marriage to Mrs. John Shorrocks, the grandpa finally teaches a lesson to his greedy daughters and sons-in-law, who obviously repent their behavior, matter to the grandfather, and feel guilty of neglecting him. Thus, with the play, William Stanley Houghton satirizes the degradation of the moral values in the British middle class.
Victoria, if that's your uncle and aunt, you are not to open the door.
Mother, it's them.
You are not to open the door till I come down. Let them knock away. Quick, Henry, quick. Quick. Mind the wall, Henry. Oof, that was a near thing. Open the door, Victoria. Henry, get your coat on and take this and sit down.
Victoria ushers in Ben and Mrs. Jordan and their son Jimmy. She is a stout, complacent woman with an irritating air of being always right. Both Mr. and Mrs. Jordan are clad in deadly outfit of new black mourning.
Well, Amelia, and he's gone at last.
Yes, he's gone. He was 72 a fortnight last Sunday.
Now, Amelia, you mustn't give way. We have all got to die sometime or the other.
I don't see how.
It might have been one of us.
What do you mean?
Oh, sorry.
By the way, it's taken you a long time to get here, Elizabeth.
Oh, I couldn't do it. I really couldn't do it.
Couldn't do? What?
I couldn't start without getting my morning dress ready.
We have ordered ours, you may be sure. I never could fancy buying ready-made things.
For myself, it's such a relief to get into the black. And now perhaps you will tell us all about it. What did the doctor say?
Oh, doctor, he's not been near yet.
Not been near?
Didn't you send for him at once?
Of course I did. Do you take me for a fool? I sent Henry at once to Dr. Pringle, but he was out.
You should have gone for another, right, Eliza?
Oh yes, it's a fatal mistake.
Dr. Pringle attended him when he was alive. And Dr. Pringle shall attend him when he's dead. That's professional etiquette.
Well, you know your own business best, but...
Stop it, Ben. It's a fatal mistake.
Don't talk so silly, Elizabeth. What good could a doctor have done?
Look at the many cases of persons being restored to life hours after they were thought to be gone.
But that's when they have been drowned. And I remember your father wasn't drowned, Eliza.
There wasn't much fear of that. If there was one thing he could bear, it was water.
Ben!
I'm sure he was regular enough. Father had been merry this morning. He went out soon after having his breakfast to pay his insurance.
My word, it's a good thing he did.
He was too honorable to have gone without paying his premium.
He must have gone down to Ringovels afterwards, for he came as merry as a sandboy. Then he came to Henry and said he'll not have his dinner and straight away went to his room. When we had finished dinner, I thought of taking a bit of something on a tray. He was lying there for all the world as if he was asleep. So I put the tray down on the bureau, chest of drawers, and went to waken him. He was quite cold.
Then I heard Amelia calling for me and I ran upstairs.
Of course, we could do nothing.
He left us all.
He was gone.
There wasn't any doubt.
I always knew he would go sudden in the end.
Well, will you go up and look at him now, or shall we have a tea?
Well, then if the kettle is ready, then we may as well have tea first.
But one thing we may as well decide now is the announcement in the papers.
I saw words in the evening news yesterday. Proper poetry it was and it rhymed. Despised and forgotten by some, you may be, but the spot that contains you is sacred to we.
Oh, that will never do. You don't say sacred to we.
You won't say it if you were speaking properly. But that's different in poetry.
Oh yes, poetic license, you know.
Well, we'll think about it after tea. Then we'll look through his bits of things and make a list of them. There is all furniture in his room.
But there's no jewelry or valuables of that sort.
Except his gold watch. He promised that to our Jimmy.
Promised to your Jimmy? I never heard of that.
Oh, but he did, Amelia, when he was living with us. He was very fond of Jimmy.
Well, I don't know.
Anyhow, there's his insurance money. Have you got the receipt for the premium he paid this morning?
I've not seen it.
Mother, I don't think Grandpa went to pay his insurance this morning.
He went out?
Yes, but he didn't go into the town. He met old Mr. Tattersall down the street and they both went off past St. Philip's Church.
To the Ringo Bells. I'll be bound.
The Ringo Bells?
That liquor house that John Shorrock's widow keeps. He's always hanging out there. Oh, if he hasn't paid it.
Do you think it was overdue?
I should think it was overdue.
Something tells me he's not paid it.
The drunken old beggar.
After all I've done for him, to put up with him in the house these 3 years, it's nothing short of swindling.
I had to put up with him for 5 years, Amelia.
And you were trying to turn him over to us all the time.
But one thing we may as remember is that he has not paid his premium.
Victoria, run upstairs and fetch that bunch of keys that's on your grandpa's dressing table.
In grandpa's room?
Yes.
I don't like to.
Don't talk so silly, Victoria. This no one can hurt you.
Can I take Jimmy with
me? No!
Come, Jimmy.
We'll see if he has locked the receipt in the bureau.
In where? In this thing?
Where did you pick that up, Amelia? It's new since last I was here.
Henry picked it up one day.
I like it. It's artistic. Did you buy it at an auction, Henry?
Where did I buy it, Amelia?
Yes, at an auction.
Oh, second hand.
Don't show your ignorance, Ben. All artistic things are second hand.
Mother.
What is it, child?
Mother, Grandpa's getting up.
Do you see?
Grandpa's getting up.
You better go up and see for yourself, Amelia. Yeah.
Come with me, Henry. Come. Shh. Come.
Listen.
Everyone in the family is startled by the sound of Grandfather. Grandpa is dressed in a gay dressing gown in his stockinged feet. Although 70, he is vigorous and well-colored. He is obviously either the grandfather or else his ghost.
What's the matter with little Vicky? Oh, hello. What brings you here? How's yourself, Ben? And Lizzie?
Grandpa, is that you?
Of course it's me. Don't do that, Melia.
He's not dead.
Doesn't seem like it.
You've kept away long enough, Lizzie. And now you've come. You don't seem overpleased to see me.
You took us by surprise, Father. Are you quite well?
What?
Are you quite well, Father?
Yeah, I'm right enough. But for a bit of headache. I wouldn't mind betting that I'm not the first in this house to be carried to the cemetery. Henry looks none so better. Melia, what the dickens did I do with my new slippers?
Aren't they by the hearse, Grandpa?
I don't see them. Why, Henry? Why you have put them on? Give them back to me.
I told him to put them on, to stretch them. They were that new and hard. Grandpa?
Hold it, Vicky.
Thanks. Oh, Grandpa, I'm so glad that you are not
dead. Hold your tongue, Victoria.
Huh? What's that? Who's gone dead?
Victoria says she's sorry for your head.
Ah, thanks, Vicky. But I'm feeling better now.
He's so fond of our Victoria.
Oh, yes, yes. He's very fond of our Jimmy, too.
You would better ask him if he has promised his gold watch to your Jimmy.
Oh, I couldn't just now.
Why, Ben? You're in mourning? And Lizzie, too? And Henry? Melia? Little Vicky? Who's gone dead? Is this someone in the family?
No one, Grandpa. A relation of Ben's.
And what relation of Ben's?
His brother.
Damn it! I never had one.
Dear. What was his name, Ben?
Alfred.
Frederick.
Alfred.
Alfred? And where did your brother Alfred die?
In Australia.
Ah, he might be older than you, right?
Yes, 5 years.
Okay. Are you going to the funeral?
Yes.
No,
of course not.
Well, I suppose you have been waiting for me only to begin tea. I am feeling hungry.
I'll make tea. Henry, give Grandpa some pie.
Thank you. I'll make a start.
Grandpa.
Glad to see you have got an appetite, Mr. Merriweather. Although you have not been so well.
Nothing serious, Ben. I've been lying down for a bit.
Been to sleep, Grandpa?
No, I've not been to sleep.
Oh.
I can't exactly call everything to mind. But I remember, I was a bit dazed.
Could you see any of Mr. Merriweather?
Yes. But I don't remember seeing anything particular. Salt, Ben?
Of course not, Grandpa. It was all your fancy. You must have been asleep.
I wasn't been to sleep, Amelia. Damn it. I ought to know.
Didn't you see Henry or Amelia come into your room?
Now let me think.
I won't press him, Elizabeth. Don't press him.
No, I won't worry him.
Ah, begad! What the devil did you mean by shifting my bureau out of my bedroom? Amelia? Henry, do you hear me?
What bureau was that, Father?
Why? My bureau, the one I bought.
Was it that one, Father?
Ah, that's it. What is it doing here? Wait. Drat me if that is in my clock too. What the devil is been going on in this house?
Well, I will be hanged.
Well, I tell you what's going on in this house, Father. Nothing short of robbery.
Quiet, Elizabeth.
I'll not be quiet.
Come on, Elizabeth.
Eliza has every right to speak her own mind.
Then she can speak it outside, not here.
Damn it all. Will someone tell me what is going on in this house?
Yes, I will, Father. I'll not see you robbed.
Who is robbing me?
Henry and Amelia. They have stolen your clock, bureau and slippers. They sneaked into your room like a thief in the night and stole them after you were dead.
God,
Elizabeth!
Stop it, Henry!
I'll not be stopped after you were dead, I say.
After who was dead?
You!
But I'm not dead.
No, but they thought you were.
Oh, so that's why you're all in black today? You thought I was dead? That was the biggest mistake.
Grandpa, I'm sorry.
It didn't take you long to start dividing my things among yourself.
No, Father. You mustn't think of that.
Melia, you always were a keen one to me. I suppose you thought the will wasn't fair.
But did you make a will?
Yes. It was locked up in the bureau.
And what was in it, Father?
That doesn't matter now. I am thinking of destroying it and making another one.
Grandpa, you'll not be hard on me.
I'll trouble you for another cup of tea, Melia. 2 lumps and plenty of milk.
With pleasure, Grandpa.
I don't want to be hard on anyone. Thank you. I'll tell you what I'm going to do now. Since your mother died, I've lived a part of my life with you, Melia, and a part of my life with you, Lizzie. Well, I shall make a new will, leaving all my bits of things to whomever I am living with when I die. How does that strike you?
Oh, it's a bit of lottery for us.
And who do you intend to live with from now, Father?
I'm just coming to that.
You know, Father, it's quite time you came to live with us again. We would make you very comfortable.
No, he has not been with us. as long as he has been with you.
Well, I may be wrong, but I don't think father will fancy living on with you after what happened today.
All I can say is Elizabeth's changed her mind in the last 2 years. Grandpa, do you know what the quarrel between us was about?
Don't be a fool, Amelia. Sit down.
We quarreled because Elizabeth
said. Stop it, Amelia.
We quarreled because Elizabeth said she had enough of you to last a lifetime and we had got to keep you.
All right. Quiet. Be seated.
Sorry, Father.
It seems to me that neither of you has any cause to feel proud about the way you have treated me.
If I've done anything wrong, I'm sure. I'm sorry for it, Grandpa.
And I can't say more than that too.
It's a bit late to say it now. You neither of you care to put up with me.
No, Father.
Come, Mr. Merriweather. You have got to live with one of your daughters.
I'll tell you what I'm going to do now. Excuse me. On Monday next, I've got to do 3 things. First, I've got to go to my lawyer and alter my will. Second, I've got to go to my insurance office and pay my premium. Third, I've got to go to St. Philip's Church and get married.
What?
Get married?
How does that strike you?
He's out of his senses.
I said I'm going to get married.
With whom?
To Mrs. John Shorrocks, who keeps the Ringovels. We have fixed up good while now, but I've kept it for a pleasant surprise. Here she is.
Hello everyone, how are you all? And how's my new family?
Oh, I love my new grandma.
I felt I was a bit burdened on new people. So I found someone who would think it a pleasant surprise to look after me. We'll be glad to see you at the ceremony. Till Monday next, 12 o'clock at St. Philip's Church. Bye.
With the announcement of his marriage to Mrs. John Shorrocks, the grandpa finally teaches a lesson to his greedy daughters and sons-in-law, who obviously repent their behavior, meant it to the grandfather, and feel guilty of neglecting him. Thus,